This is a few days before. When I got ready for also desification symposium, my haircut and me, I showing him and turning the pages of Diva's dentistry book, showing him a red carpet evening. He loved it. And then he asked, what is the next? Well, also densification word symposium in Arizona. Wow, Arizona word symposium. What? Us? It's, you know, it's like about the bus, about the drills. And this face expression was frozen on his face. It wasn't that face fancy, you know, drills and bus. And then I gave my best to explain. Actually, it's not about the drills, about the birth. It is entire philosophy. It is about implant site preservation. It is about nature preservation. But it didn't help. It didn't help until I showed him this. He loved it. Great design done by Versach team member, Christine Burns. Christine Burns, where are you? Thank you so much. Great work. And thank you, Versach team, for having invited me to be a part of this nature preservation celebration. So, let's go to the topic. It is about ossodensification during and after autogenous grafting. The most of my Denzach cases are not spectacular. It is because I utilize them for all my implant site preparations, and not all my implant site preparations are spectacular. I'm going to show a little bit about everyday Denzach utilization, and I refrain completely from showing the literature. There is great literature about ossodensification, about Denzach births, to be found on the web page. I'm going to show ossodensification during and after autogenous tissue grafting. And since Hovey has shown a Curry technique, I'm not going to repeat it. I'm not going to talk about Curry technique. I'm going to talk only about to focus only on the beauty of tuberosity and dentin grafted sites. This is my statistics. My statistics showing a crestal sinus lift approach and lateral window approach from 2015 when I started with Denzach births until today. This statistic is showing that I'm a hardworking surgeon, and this statistic is showing that my patients get less and less swelling and less postoperative morbidity. Yes, I still do lateral sinus window. All these cases are crestal sinus lift approach. I know there is zero tolerance from Ziv, from Salah for lateral sinus window, but I still do it mostly for the cases where I utilize the sinus window bone plate for Curry technique. And if there are more than two implant sites, I'm faster with lateral window. And I still cannot also densify the air like big boys here. But I will try, give my best. And these crestal sinus lifts radiograms don't look spectacular. This video got viral. I opened the sinus window only to show this amazing autografting. But, you know, CBCT after the implant osso integration shows mostly a modest result. Sometimes a little bit opacity, a little bit more in my hands independently if it's also PRF edit or not. So I keep grafting underneath the Schneideral membrane. Mostly I utilize collagenized xenograft, and I don't like this procedure. It takes a long. And I think I'm weltmaster in feeding the patients with particulate bone material. I am really
Then I found out something that I wanted to share with you. It's very, very simple and does it work? Very simple and very inexpensive augmentation material. It is simple collagen sponge. Collagen sponge gets resorbed very fast, and you wouldn't expect that it has this tenting effect and makes bone grafting possible. But in order to push it through the implant site, it must be squeezed. It must be densified like a ball. And it seems that it prolongs this resorption time. And this is very in accordance with recently published video on Dental XP. It is about the collagen ball technique for soft tissue augmentation. This article is going to be published in 2020. Maurice Salama is co-author of this article. And it is immediately after the implant placement, it looks like implants are in the sinus. It looks like this also after 3 months, and it takes about 6 months to have this opacity. Very inexpensive, very cheap, and it works really good. But nevertheless, I was green with envy with all Chucks and Zivs and Narayans and Salahs showing beautiful balloons in the sinus. And only because they have this Novabone pistol. And I couldn't get this Novabone pistol in Croatia. Sri promised it 1 year ago. When I told him that yesterday I got two of them, but only yesterday. But then finally, the Italian company where I'm buying my collagenized xenograft finally designed applicator for putty bone. And now I can finally boast like a big boy with balloons in the sinus. It makes fun and it is fast. And I stopped feeding my patients with particulate material. But, independent on the beauty of this radiology of the balloons, there is one grafting material that I prefer over all others, and also for the sinus lifting in crestal approach. And this is piece of corticocancellous tuberosity. It causes almost no additional morbidity to harvest it in the posterior mandibula. Also densified in the implant site, it improves implant site. And it is really fast procedure to do it. Here, the implant uncoverage procedure. And what I like about this tuberosity, it is how it looks like at CBCT. Already after 4 months, that is almost impossible to tell the difference between the original bone and the added bone. It looks like it's going to stay there. Mostly, we handle not only the vertically insufficient ridge dimension in the posterior maxilla, but also the horizontally at the same time. And this is what already the speakers before me warned, Maurice especially. We have to expand this ridge, we do at the same time the sinus elevation, but the fact that we both expensive, danceable, sorry Salah, they're expensive but worth every penny, you know. It does not mean that it's everything that should be done. The same rules must be followed as in the general implantology, bone to implant ratio. We tend to do in order to get primary stability, if the residual ridge height is very low, we tend to do a too much compression in the cervical part. Just that what Maurice just talked about. It requires veneer grafting. And if we don't follow these rules, we have to talk with our patients about 80 or 70%. This is how it should be done. Narrow ridge is expanded utilizing osseodensification. There was nice trabecular bone. In this case, like almost in all my cases last year, the buccal sliding palatal flap is utilized. This buccal sliding palatal flap I introduced at the last Dental XP symposium in New York. It is simply the flap design as introduced by Tarnow and Scharf for the buccal roll flap, but it's not rolled underneath the buccal flap. It is utilized for the primary wound closure. The same flap design, the Merlin and Jorge Campos utilized at the implant uncoverage procedure to cover the exposed bone. And it can be very, very good utilized for the primary wound closure. And this way, the coronary flap repositioning of the buccal flap is reduced or avoided. This is the beauty of the denser birth, the beauty of the osseodensification, because our implant is now inside the bone envelope. And there is a difference, as already mentioned yesterday, there is a difference if we do veneer grafting on the titanium or on the buccal bone. Veneer grafting, almost lasso, almost. And the closure with very, very reduced coronary flap repositioning. The healing is always like this because this connective tissue is pediculated and it heals very good. And at the implant uncoverage procedure, additionally, buccal sliding, the buccal roll flap, 6 millimeter healing abutments are placed. It means we do have 4 millimeter soft tissue thickness. Great soft tissue thickness to start with it. This is a case, 79 years old professor from Croatia, very active, still lecturing. He was referred to me to rebuild his maxilla in order to place later implants. But thanks to Denzabers, and really thanks to Denzabers, I was able to place all implants inside the bone envelope to get a nice primary implant stability and to provide him with immediately loaded provisional. Of course, here on the pictures, I am focused on the most narrow part of the ridge. All implants are placed inside the bone envelope, but this thin ridge requires grafting. Decent veneer grafting, it is a PRF block done in Simon Pieri style with LPRF membranes. Radiogram immediately after the implant placement, clinical situation, provisional bridge, and 3 months after the tissue maturation, implant osseointegration, the patient came back for the implants in the low jaw. He had some residual teeth, vital teeth, and these teeth were cleaned, grinded, sterilized, and utilized as dentin autograft again for veneer grafting with LPRF membranes. In posterior area, connective tissue grafts to enhance soft tissue volume. In anterior area, there is a free gingiva graft, vestibuloplasty with free gingiva graft, patient with provisional teeth, and this is how it looks like after the tissue maturation. It looks stable, it looks like it's going to resist. It's going to be fine. Patient with a definitive prosthesis. Another thin ridge, pneumatized sinuses, and also residual defect after cystectomy. And also in this case, I was able to place implants with good primary stability. But this patient, she was completely other than all my patients. She said that she gives her entire life savings for this treatment, and she wants the most safe procedure. And she doesn't care if she's going to have a provisional bridge now or in 4 months. So what I have done veneer grafting after implant placement, not only on the buccal, but also on the palatal for the very thin ridge and the residual defect. Provisional implants were placed to protect these grafted areas. And this is the last time when I saw the patient. It was in September, and she was so happy with provisional teeth. I hope she's going to come back. She was supposed to come in December. I shortened this part after Isaac lecture. This is just one case showing when the residual ridge is very thin, I used to do additionally to expansion with DensaBurs, a vertical cut like a ridge splitting, and then DensaBurs to open further the space to work with trabecular bone, and always pay attention, always healing abutments underneath the flap. It is guided soft tissue augmentation in order to gain more vertical volume. And this is the patient with provisional and CBCT control afterward. I do a lot of procedures like this, and they, like Isaac said, work really predictably. But something interesting. Talking about ridge expansion, or here some ridge splitting, there is a nice ODE protocol. It is 6 out of 6, I think, guided expansion graft. My problem is this, that in Croatia, I don't have allograft. What should I put inside in this sandwich? I don't want to have xenograft to build my future implant site. But I found there is something really, really nice. Piece of corticocancellous tuberosity. Just take a piece of corticocancellous tuberosity. It is wedged into this space. It wasn't necessary to stage procedure here. I could have placed implant. It would have been prettier for this meeting, but I was anyway busy in posterior maxilla and other parts of this patient, so I staged the procedure to enhance a vertical soft tissue volume. Pediculated connective tissue graft is placed, and this is how it looks like at re-entry. This bone, real bone, and this is also the beauty of tuberosity, because harvesting almost doesn't cause any morbidity, any pain. Another example with tuberosity. I use my chance before Martin De Rosa show his tuberosity. You won't pay attention to my cases afterward. In 2017, this article is published. This article about the flip approach for reconstruction of the severely resorbed posterior maxilla. Basically, the top of the tuberosity is cut off, and it is shaped and fitted into the posterior maxilla defect, and the implant is utilized at the same time as fixation screw, implant and fixation screw. And because we do have DensaBurs, we can play this game even better. Look at the difference after the first DensaBurs moved this bone. we already have a nice amount of bone around our future implant site. And then a piece of cortical tuberosity is additionally harvested, simply placed into this defect, also densified implant at the time of re-entry. Radiogram immediately after the implant placement, of course, before and then after the implant osseo integration. Very similar case. The second molar is hopeless. There is also a vertical ridge resorption. The site after the tooth was taken out. Again, a piece of cortical tuberosity is harvested, also densified, implants are placed, and here CBCT after the implant osseo integration and the clinical situation. Works very nice, and it doesn't cause any additional morbidity. It is here in the adjacent area, and tuberosity is really forgivable. I love to expand and to also densify septum if there is nice trabecular bone there. And I won't show many cases. I left it for Samuel and Chuck. They have really amazing stuff. But it is really nice to do it. It's really fun to observe this septum that is going to be wider and wider, never stopping. Here is the case, the premolar with the partial extraction therapy, socket shield. I'm also from the clan, from Believer, and the molar placed into the septum. Grafted with collagenized xenograft, and this is how it looks like when the tissue was made for the definitive prostodontics. But not always we do have a nice septum to be expanded and also densified. Sometimes there is a septum resorption, or the roots are fused, or we destroy it during tooth extraction. And then we do have defects like this. Here, partial extraction therapy, distal buccal root is submerged and the mesiobuccal on the mesiobuccal is socket shield. And then again, a piece of corticocancellous tuberosity is harvested. It is placed into this defect. And then densified. And it looks like this. This huge defect became a decent implant site, and this is the patient immediately after the surgery. I asked him to come, he's a brother of my assistant, to come a few days ago to place a VPI abutment to be able to show it today. It was 8 weeks after implant placement and ISQ was 82. This case is like an introduction into Chuck's presentation, SPOT protocol. SPOT, site preservation of tissue. In this case, it's almost everything what we admire. What I mean when I say we, all of us that love and admire partial extraction therapy, also densification, autogenous tissue, IDR, orthodontic extrusion, it's the same. In this case, the left central incisor is hopeless, the buccally partial bone dehiscence. The first premolar has a palatal bone resorption, but partial extraction therapy can be done, socket shield, and there is 6 millimeter residual ridge high in the molar area. Here's the plan for the implant placement. Implant plus tuberosity, late implant placement, socket shield, and then crestal sinus elevation. The central incisor was extracted and piece of corticocancellous tuberosity is shaped to fit nice into this socket. And then it is also densified with Densabors. And I really love what I see after the tuberosity also densification. It is like socket shield. It is what Paulo Coelho yesterday said. Bone that is also densified doesn't show such remodeling after 6 weeks. And it really looks like it's going to stay here. Partial extraction therapy on the first premolar and crestal sinus elevation utilizing Densabors. It is with tuberosity augmented, tuberosity graft. And it looks like socket shield. On the left, patient with provisionals, and here after the definitive prostodontics delivery. Another patient, she is DSD patient, she came to improve her smile, knowing that he needs implants in the on the lateral. But what she didn't know, and restorative dentist also didn't know, there is a fistula, there is a drain. It means it's going to be complicated. Two adjacent teeth in aesthetic area, the left lateral incisor and the canine. Let's go back, CBCT. Very often, I find in aesthetic area treating adjacent teeth that I cannot do my favorite procedure for both teeth. This is socket shield, but one of the socket has a missing bone and I do my Myvan technique or I utilize tuberosity. I don't dare to call it IDR from respect to Martins de Rosa. It is not. Okay, in this case, the teeth were prepared prior to the tooth extraction. The patient is going to have a fixed provisional bridge. A piece of tuberosity is harvested, and this is what Ziv has shown yesterday. I'm sure Martins de Rosa is going to explain step by step how to harvest tuberosity. And what helps is this scan mate used as retractor. The patients really loved it. It is relatively new in my office, and I forget to put it on the tray, but and my assistants forget to use it each time, and then when she changed, the patient asked, really. And again, socket shield for the canine and tuberosity for the lateral incisor. Cortical part of the tuberosity to the buccal and to close socket orificium, and also densified again. Giving, you feel confident when it's also densified. Immediately after the surgery and after the healing, partial extraction therapy, nicely maintained rich structure, some pediculated connective tissue graft to improve further soft tissue in the lateral area. Immediately after the crowns were placed, I don't have Photoshop, and here I demonstrate that I don't have it. And look at this lateral incisor and canine after the prostodont, after the crowns were inserted. Everything is kept. Another utilization of tuberosity, the right lateral incisor, very, very simple way to treat it with almost without any post-operative morbidity almost without any skills to treat it. The tooth is taken out. Laser is utilized to decontaminate this site. And piece of corticocancellous tuberosity is again shaped. It takes time, you know, you take your forceps, your tools, and to shape it, to wedge it into the defect. It is simply covered with IPRF, and this is how it looks like. CBCT before and CBCT after. No fixation screws, no flaps, nothing. Rich, again, the buccal sliding palatal flap for implant placement because we need some veneer grafting. Of course, osseo densification, denser burst, some rich expansion. And then veneer grafting and wound closure, again the coronary flap displacement is avoided. Again, two adjacent teeth, failing teeth in aesthetic area. This time without implant placement, it is only about pontic site preservation. And there is no better way for site preservation than partial extraction therapy. But partial extraction therapy, again, has contraindications. And if the buccal bone wall is missing, like for this site, partial extraction therapy cannot be utilized. For the canine, a piece of tuberosity, corticocancellous tuberosity. It is so simple. Just collagen sponge to close the site, and this is how it looks like after the healing. Doesn't cost anything, very easy to do, and the tissue is maintained. We are celebrating nature preservation today. In 2017, this article is published. This is about tuberosity composite graft for immediate reconstruction of failed implants in aesthetic area. It was published in 2017. Of course, we have done it before it's published. One of my patients, it is radiogram from 2013, when the patient came for implant placement in the upper jaw and his implants on the left side showing already peri-implantitis. It progressed with time. We can see it in the lower jaw, not exactly in the upper jaw, but look at this clinical appearance. And then again, very simple procedure. It wasn't a big deal to extract both of these implants, and the composite tuberosity was on the way, adjacent, in this area. So I harvested composite piece of tuberosity, and in difference to the authors that published this article, I left also epithelium. I needed this epithelium because I thought I want to have a more vertical dimension. Maybe it stays. It has the whole blood supply. So the bone to the bone, periosteum to the periosteum, connective tissue to the connective tissue, and this is how it looks like at the reentry, at the time of implant placement, and later on the radiogram. Very easy, very straightforward procedure. Some no-name flipping and rotating of the flaps to get more soft tissue volume here. Another utilization of composite tuberosity graft. Failing implant in the lower jaw, and look at this rich concavity due to atrophy. Again, no implants are planned. It means no denser burst, composite tuberosity graft is harvested, including also epithelium. And it looks like mess. But when you do it, it's not mess. you see everything. And then the bone to the bone, connective tissue to the connective tissue, epithelium to the epithelium. And it is so wedged and shaped that I needed only one screw to fixate this piece of tuberosity, composite tuberosity graft. PRF was utilized to cover donor and recipient site. And what I regret until today, is that I didn't have done any attempt to cover this recession. But maybe better that I haven't done it, because we can follow this case and see it's not other case or Photoshop, because the further development was surprisingly also for me. Okay, let's see side by side. Before surgery, immediately after the surgery, I haven't done attempt to rebuild the vertical dimension. A new patient is going to have the bridge again. I need keratinized gingiva. I need some volume to avoid foot impaction, but I didn't have more ambitions. And this is how it looks like after 4 months. It is like this piece of tissue continued to grow. And then another 5 months, when the patient got provisional. You see, tooth with recession, it is the same patient. And finally, patient with definitive prostodontics. Very easy treatment, almost no post-operative morbidity, and it works really nice. By the way, this patient is a full arch, partial extraction therapy, full guided implant placement. I'm going to present this case at Dental XP Symposium in Florida in 2 months. Mish published already 20 years ago a composite graft for the socket preservation. Here, unfortunately, after the implants were already also integrated, the canine failed. It was a mesiodistal fracture of the canine. And this composite tuberosity graft was utilized to graft the socket. But it is not a simple socket, it is socket with socket shield. It's thin in the coronal area. This is what Hovey explained yesterday. And again, I kept also epithelium, shaped this piece of tuberosity into the socket and sutured it. What I found, it is hard tissue. I dare to say it is bone, although Mondo would say, I don't have histology and I'm not allowed to say it is a bone. My Orlando group is laughing. And this bone wants to have Denzabers in order to place an implant. And I was really delighted and happy to see this bone. And now, many of you, even if you already do partial extraction therapy, you are wondering, why am I so happy to see hard tissue in the socket with socket shield? Because we are not used to see it. What do we see mostly is soft tissue invagination. This is what we see when we uncover the site, when we have previously done socket shield, to maintain the ridge in order to place implant in few months' time. And when we come back to this side, there is soft tissue invagination. And I have to admit, it is embarrassing, of course, but I didn't count on it, that the socket healing is so, there is so big difference between sockets with socket shield and without socket shield. And what about the gap? What is if the implant is in the socket? Do we also have a soft tissue or bone? Hovey has shown some histologies. Chuck is going to show more. But believe me, we still don't know for each situation what do we have between implant and socket shield. And we don't know which parameters influence the kind of tissue. Is it grafting? Is it quality of dentin? Is it socket shield length or thickness, or what is it about? We had our first PET consensus 2017 in Madrid. In Madrid, there is each year Jornada. And Jorge Campos Aliaga, together with Alberto, organized this Jornada. It is really great event. It is learning like here, like on Dental XP Symposia, the same spirit. And you know, we come from Europe to the States despite of immigration controls that take nerves and hours. And if you consider to go to the Europe to some conference, please come to Madrid. It's great. Okay, there was the first PET consensus. And we came to, we had, you know, to put some rules on the paper for partial extraction therapy, and then we had to decide altogether, should we fill the gap or not. So we decided we shouldn't fill the gap. And there is no scientific back up scientific evidence. Some of us haven't filled the gap, some of us have filled the gap, and the results are always nice. And for this reason, we gathered in this PET Dental XP research group to find answers to the questions like, should we fill the gap, and what happens between implant and socket shield? And it is difficult to find out. Chuck is going to show histologies, but after the implant osseointegration, integration, do you feel like doing incisions and cutting and looking what is between implant and socket shield? No, no, no. We do probe. It's always firm, but we don't really visualize what is between. So I thought one possibility to see what happens can be a glocal approach. It means socket shield with later implant placement. Of course, when an implant is placed, especially with occlusal individual healing abutment or provisional crown, it changes. It changes a lot. But we don't know how much and if. But we can see what kind of tissue develops if we do socket shields with later implant placement. This is one of my first cases where I field grafted the sockets with different autogenous materials. What I found out, empty socket is empty socket. Soft tissue invagination all the way. This is the socket filled with autogenous bone and covered with PRF membrane. 2 millimeter depth, 2 millimeter width, soft tissue invagination. IPRF, and this is interesting, look, CBCT, only autogenous bone, and CBCT, autogenous bone with IPRF. It looks so much better with IPRF, but no difference in the clinic. 2 millimeter depth, 2 millimeter width, soft tissue invagination. So I got that 32 cases and submitted them with Professor Bindemann for publication. At the moment, I'm rewriting it, okay. Meanwhile, I have about 40 cases, and we measured soft tissue invagination 4 months after the socket shield procedure with grafting with some of autogenous materials. These autogenous materials are depending on availability. For example, if I extracted vital roots, then I grinded them for dentin autograft. If I harvested connective tissue from tuberosity, I took a piece of corticocancerous tuberosity to see what happens. At the end, I had sockets empty, with, filled with PRF plug, autogenous bone particles, dentin autograft, and corticocancerous tuberosity. Typical example, socket shield, piece of corticocancerous tuberosity, PRF on the top, CBCT afterward. no soft tissue invagination, bone. Calling for Verza. Another, socket shield, very thin in coronal part, cortical cancellous tuberosity, always taking care that this cortical part is closing orificium of the socket and at the time of re-entry. Only bone, only heart tissue. No soft tissue invagination. And of course, when I found it out, I started to combine to utilize corticocancellous tuberosity with partial extraction therapy, especially in the cases like this. Look, distal on the central incisor, a vertical bone resorption, the already papilla atrophy. Socket shield is done, and then piece of cortical tuberosity wedged to support the papilla in the distal part and between socket shield and the implant. Fortunately, patient required some surgical crown lengthening, and this is the result. This is how it looks like, close look, before and after. This is a summary of these 32 cases and further cases that don't come into the paper. If the socket is left empty, there is about 40 cubic millimeter soft tissue invagination. We counted the depth and the width of soft tissue invagination in conus volume. If there is autogenous bone particles covered with PRF membrane, there is less soft tissue invagination, about 4 millimeter. And corticocancellous tuberosity and dentin autograft prevent completely soft tissue invagination. Each time, each side, I find only hard tissue, only the bone. These sides are done with dentin autograft. Both of these materials have a common slow resorption. Slow resorption rate. CBCT of the socket shield, it is rather a partial extraction therapy border case, but it could have been done, and this is how it looks like before and after. So I come to dentin autograft. Many speakers have already mentioned and showed the cases. I really love this material. I've learned about dentin autografts from Ziv and Rocco Melle. I don't know who was the first one. I love handling. You can do sticky bone, and I especially appreciate that no primary closure is necessary. I mostly put a PRF membrane or collagen sponge in order to prevent exfoliation of dentin autograft, but it's not necessary. Like here, look, here, nothing is put on the top. What I also like about dentin autograft is a rich appearance at the re-entry. It looks like bone, it smells like bone, and it feels like bone. Some veneer grafting done with dentin autograft, and here dentin autograft utilized with Curie technique, Curie bone plate, but instead of scraping, I simply placed dentin autograft. And when I build the sides, what I use for implant site preparation.
So the question is, why we extract bone bulk when we invest time and effort trying to build it?
I also like histology. There is no fibrous encapsulation of dentin autograft, but there is a contact between dentin particles and the surrounding bone. And Narayan, who is today here, when I posted this histology, he doubted, he started discussion and said, it can be new bone, but it can be new cementum. So I've done immune histochemistry with antibodies, again, osterics, showing that there is a new bone. These are osteoblasts. Let's see some cases with dentin autograft. socket type 2, almost 3, there is some recession, and this patient didn't feel like having bigger surgery that day. She had stress at home, and I respected it. I had, fortunately, she had a wisdom tooth to be grinded. Socket is filled with grinded dentin, PRF membranes simply to cover this grafting material, and this is what I found at re-entry. Again, the buccal sliding flap, and look at this nice response of dentin grafted side to the denser burst. This is what Salah asked me, I think a year ago. Take a look, how does it respond, how it looks. Salah, meanwhile, I placed implants in 134 dentin grafted sites. I lost one implant, and I will show the case. The patient ran a marathon 2 days after implant placement. Some veneer grafting, and the case when I saw the patient the last time with provisional crown. On the very beginning of 2016, the hot topic on Dental XP forum was slurry. I love this expression, Richard Martin slurry, wow. You remember our Saturday evenings talking about it, Jorge, everyone. And then before Salah could warn me about xenograft, and I was already skeptical. It's so sharp, it's so big, but I didn't have allograft, and I really desperately wanted to do what big boys have done. So I thought when I mix it 50-50, I can do slurry. As Michael said today, you can't also densify it even if it's major. You can't do slurry. You can, but you lose your implant. So I lost this implant. And I'm telling this story because the idea to slurry, to also densify dentin autograft never crossed my mind. The particles are between 300 and 1,200 micrometers. But after the graft integration, maturation, very, very nice response to the denser burst. Let's see cases with dentin autograft. The DSD patient, the canine, and the first premolar were referred for the extraction. Dentin autograft, simply the sockets filled, LPRF membrane on the top. Nothing is more simple than this at the time of implant placement and after the tissue maturation. DSD patient, very nice before and after. And this is CBCT. And this CBCT is one of the cases I'm in the middle of doing this study, radiographic analysis of mineralized dentin autograft for rich presentation. What is interesting, it is interesting, there is some horizontal ridge resorption, but look at the vertical ridge dimension. Here, 9 millimeter, 9.77. Periodontal patient, resorption of the palatal bone after dentin grafting, we got again the vertical dimension. And you can see it better for this canine. There is some horizontal resorption, but look, this horizontal resorption, because it is measured 1 millimeter from the highest point of the ridge, in order to compare it with Boozer study, there is some resorption, but why this resorption? We gained this vertical dimension. Simply by grafting the site and covering it with PRF membrane. So until today, the 42 sites are measured, and I check each site. This is the average buccal bone thickness, and this is what I found out. all these patients, the teeth were periodontal involved teeth. Otherwise, I do partial extraction therapy. And this is interesting that the gain in lingual and the buccal bone high and some horizontal ridge resorption. Patient with a very interesting smile. This is how he presented. And then I told him, I'm not going to touch you. I am not going to extract this teeth if you don't learn how to clean them. And he learned it. And he loved photo sessions. We have also 12 o'clock pictures, not here. Look at his central linear. We have done DSD planning, but we were not able to do mock-up, especially emotional mock-up, how to do it, where to put your mock-up. And so I thought, well, and here is, for my pet friends, explanation why not partial extraction therapy, because of tooth mobility and because I didn't want to place implants again in these sites where previously he had the teeth. There was a central line deviation, and I simply wanted to place implants on the other sides. So because we are not able to do a mock-up, I thought the best idea is to do a stage procedure. First, to prepare some teeth for the fixed provisional bridge, to take the teeth out, place implants, and then we can do some corrections. Low jaw, very, very thin ridge in the low jaw, defects. Okay, teeth were prepared prior to the teeth extraction. The provisional bridge was already prepared. And then dentin autograft, plenty of dentin autograft utilized for socket filling and veneer grafting, and like always in my cases, some connective tissue graft to improve a soft tissue. Immediately after the surgery with the fixed provisional bridge, and after it is 2 months after the procedure was done, still some sutures. And look how nicely this ridge dimension is maintained. Look, the central papilla here and here, or this is the first premolar. Look at the canine. This is what I've shown on CBCT, this gain in vertical dimension. The low jaw, the same procedure. My assistant's grinding and cleaning, she loves it. It's a lot of fun for her. IPRF to make it sticky, veneer grafting, healing, CBCT, occlusal view. Looks good. The incisor, veneer grafting was done. And again, gain in vertical dimension. And I check each of these sides. It's a lot of work. And mostly I ask him, dental expert, Rami Gamil, he has lecture on dental XP. So I came in contact with him. Is it possible? Please check it again. And he checked it again. And it is like this. And here we can literally see this new augmented area where we gained this dimension. So the provisional bridge was utilized as a surgical guide to place implants, flapless implant placement, thanks to nice ridge dimension. And here I opened the site simply to be able to visualize, to make a picture of the ridge after dentin grafting. Radiogram. This is how this ridge looks like. It looks like bone. Root submergence therapy in the low jaw, socket preservation in the upper jaw. And this is the last time when I saw the patient with provisional teeth. He was supposed to come 2 weeks ago. He will come next week, unfortunately. But I think it's going to be a winner case, and it looks stable. It's going to be stable. Again, introduction, my last case, introduction to Chuck's presentation, a lot of nature preservation, a lot of site preservation and nature preservation, all autogenous materials were utilized here in this case. The central incisors were submerged. Right lateral incisor socket shield, dentin autograft grafting for the lateral incisor. Look at these defects for the premolars, simply grinded teeth, the socket filled and covered with PRF. This is how it looks like already after 3 months. No surgery, no reconstructions, no bone plates, no titanium, nothing. Simple, preserved, kept what the patient already had. And this is how this look again, this ridge looks like at reentry, the partial extraction therapy for the molar, socket shield, and the submerged root. I took histology for the case, again, sinus elevation utilizing a piece of tuberosity, my favorite material. And this is how it looks like at the end. Very natural, nice, and I think stable. I have my knowledge about osseodensification mostly from Forum Dental XP, from Verzach webpage, and most of all from my Orlando group. Almost all of us today here, and thanks to Salah, we are teaching here. Thank you. And not finished. If you think, excuse me, can you put it back? James, Jonathan, what was the name, Howie? James. Okay. If you think you can learn, some of you, something from me, I give 4 days courses in the IDEA Center in San Francisco. Lot of soft tissue, partial extraction therapy, also densification. Really nice educational center. And not everything goes smoothly. I showed nice cases, but we all cook with water. Sometimes we are struggling with this membrane and we push not in the right moment and it doesn't elevate and sometimes the ridge fractures. And, you know, people say after the lecture, one don't remember what about was the lecture. Please remember, it was about osseodensification and the beauty of tuberosity and dentin autograft. And people say one remember only the feeling after the lecture. Let's be like this. And now, thank you.